with you as a product of the Learning from Leaders website and webinar series initiative. In partnership with Verizon, NCLR has created this site to share lessons of its network of successful Latino-serving affiliate schools with the broader education community. On it, you will find some of the best and most useful materials from NCLR and its school communities in areas including cultural competence, family engagement, leadership development, and English learners. Please visit and share across your networks at www.nclr.org/LFL. While the webinar is happening, you should be able to view our presentation on your screen and hear our speakers. For the sake of sound quality, all participants will be muted while the presentation is happening. On your screen, you should see a small box with the information about the call. If you have questions for our presenters, please type them in the chat box. At the end of the presentation, we will answer questions submitted via chat. If there is a time after those questions have been answered, we may open up the line for additional questions. If you are having technical problems, please notify us via the same chat box. Now that I have discussed the general structure of our webinar, it is now my pleasure to introduce our presenters. Dr. McLeod serves as Deputy Vice President of Education and Workforce Development at the National Council of La Raza, NCLR, in Washington, D.C. Prior to NCLR, she served as Executive Director of Student Services in the Alexandria City Public Schools. She served as Assistant Superintendent for Special Education in the District of Columbia Office of the State Superintendent of Education. She has also served as a State Title III Director, Director of Bilingual Education, Title VII Coordinator, Bilingual Program Developer, and ESL Teacher in D.C. She worked at the U.S. Department of Education's Office of Special Education and Rehabilitative Services from 1995 to 2001. In her native Puerto Rico, she taught in two Montessori schools and owned a center that provided after-school services to students with disabilities. Dr. McLeod holds a BA in Economics from the University of Puerto Rico, an MA in Special Education from New York University, and an EdD in Bilingual Special Education Leadership from George Washington University. Presenting along with Peggy is NCLR affiliate Marisol Reducha, who implements Common Core State Standards in California. Marisol Reducha is the director of MAC Community Charter School, MCCS, an alternative high school of choice authorized by the Sweetwater Union High School District located 7 miles from the Mexico border. Marisol was born and raised in San Diego, California, where she struggled through her teenage years, influenced by the reality of the inner city. As a single mother with a child on each hip, she earned her bachelor's degree in English at San Diego State University in 1998. Between 1999 and 2006, she taught middle and high school students while earning her master's degree in educational leadership at San Diego State University. Marisol was an elementary assistant principal and principal in the South Union Bay High School District until January of 2012, when she joined MAC Community Charter School. Under her leadership, the school received a full 3-year initial Western Association of Schools and Colleges accreditation, a $25,000 grant from the National Council of La Raza to implement the Escalera internship program, a $5,000 GASA service learning grant from NCLR, and has developed partnerships with other community-based organizations to support the needs of students. Marisol is an alumna of the NCLR's National Institute for Latino School Leaders and continues to advocate for the needs of all students. As communicated in the recent email, this webinar is social. So during the webinar, we encourage you to share what you're learning. We also want you to share your own stories and personal experiences in the school. We've teamed up with NCLR's social media to help you do that. During the webinar, take to Twitter and Facebook and use the hashtag #LearningFromLeaders in your tweets or posts. They'll be featured on the NCLR blog, and some will even be retweeted by NCLR. It's a simple and great way to keep the conversation going online and to connect with other fellow school leaders, teachers, and community members. As a reminder, we will collect questions for our presenter via the chat box at the end of the presentation. We will answer all questions. And now, it is time for our feature presentation.
Good morning, everyone, and good afternoon. My name is Peggy McLeod, as Aurelia said, and I'm Deputy Vice President for Education Workforce Development here at NCLR. Before I get started, I would like to thank Marisol Verrucha for joining us today. We feel that our partnership with our schools is what makes NCLR, and with our affiliates, is what makes NCLR so strong an organization. You'll see on your screen the goals and the outcomes for this session, and you're probably wondering why we're having this webinar now instead of perhaps in 2011 or 2012 when the states had adopted the Common Core state standards and everybody was focused on the adoption and then the issues of implementation. And now implementation is in fact in full swing in most states, and that's why we wanted to come back to the Common Core, because a lot of times we have the situation where policy is made, standards are adopted, the implementation is supposed to be flowing, and we kind of forget that that is really the heavy lift. So we wanted to go back and then at this point come back to the implementation and share what one of our schools is doing and how this particular school with a very challenging population has in fact successfully implemented the Common Core state standards. NCLR supports the Common Core state standards in both our national and our state level advocacy work, and we support its implementation through our network of charter schools. In addition to that, we also thought that this would be a good time to come back to the Common Core state standards because of the pushback that the standards are receiving in a number of states. I'd like to let you know that we are working in five different states to address the issue of the pushback against the standards. My next slide is going to tell you a little bit about why we feel that the standards are so important for our schools. And before I go into this, I should tell you that we have a network of approximately 100 charter schools, and they serve mostly Latino students and a lot of English learners. And as we looked at the Common Core when they were being first developed and based on college and aligned to college and career standards, as you all know, we thought that one of the great promises of the Common Core was to transform the education of English language learners. Because these goals go, they're aligned to the college and career standards. The Common Core are fewer and deeper, and they are structured so they spiral across grade levels. What does this mean? Basically, that we have the opportunity to have fewer standards that go deeper and get, and concepts get repeated throughout a student's career. You will recall when we had more standards that teachers really struggled to make sure that they had covered all of the standards, and it was kind of crazy. You know, you had to cover 100 standards, and a lot of times they were unrelated to what was happening in other grade levels. This has now disappeared. We also think that it's important that the Common Core focus on language development across all domains. I'm referring to, of course, not only reading and writing, but speaking and listening, which is exactly what English learners need to do. So they're consistent with what we want to see in terms of instruction for English language learners. Now, we feel that charter schools have a number of advantages, and these are the ones that have allowed our charters to implement the Common Core in ways that perhaps are more difficult for traditional schools. So our schools, the NCLR schools, were all created to focus on college and career readiness, particularly our high schools, but even I think our early childhood centers already have a focus on college and career readiness, and certainly it's very evident in our elementary schools, our middle schools, and especially our high schools. This flexibility allows them to have expanded learning opportunities. Many of our schools do not operate in traditional hours. They go beyond the traditional day and offer extensive programming after school hours and throughout the summer. They're also more focused on parent engagement. Many of our charter schools were, in fact, created because of students, Latino students, and their families not being served by traditional public schools. So our schools were set up to precisely welcome Latino students, their parents, and our schools are also quite culturally competent and have culturally relevant curricula. The implications for planning of the Common Core are many. We thought that some of these, although you're in full implementation, some of these were important enough to just mention one more time. The issue of collaboration is a must. There's just no possibility of implementing the new state standards if there's no collaboration across the both across different grade levels and across different areas in school. Planning for special population first, this continues to be a really important issue. You have to plan for your English language learners and for your kids with disabilities first in order to make sure that they are equally served by the new standards. Teachers have to understand the built-in coherence of the Common Core, so the spiraling of concepts across grade levels. If you don't have, if schools don't have meeting time or collaboration time where teachers from ninth grade are collaborating with teachers from 12th grade, you miss completely the wonderful capacity or the wonderful opportunity to continue to create deeper understanding in students of the different concepts. And as a result of this, the professional development in school is going to look very different. In terms of professional development, what we do is, what we have is that now, as I said, the curriculum really needs to be connected at all grade levels. The issue of literacy development is one that is shared, is a shared responsibility. It's no longer the responsibility of the English language arts teacher to develop literacy. And again, this goes back to the issue of language it's language development, it's literacy and language development across all domains. Professional development is intended to change the school's culture. And what I mean by this is basically that the way that the school is structured has to completely change and has completely changed, as Marisol is going to talk about in when she talks about her school. But you will not, in a school that is fully implementing the Common Core State Standards, you should never see a teacher lecturing for hours on end, standing at the head of the class, and students never speaking, which of course reflects the shifts in the way that instruction is carried out. So together with this, there are certain considerations, such as making sure that as we move to the new assessments, all of their, as you know, there are two consortia, the Smarter Balanced and PARC, and most of the states have chosen to go with one or the other. These are going to be assessments, unlike the ones before that were paper and pencil. These new assessments will be on a computer platform. So there are issues related to hardware that I know principals are still struggling with. Internet access. Students must be technologically literate and have digital reading skills. In other words, they're not going to be reading material on paper. They're going to be reading material on a computer, so they have to be ready for that. And then finally, there are new formats with these assessments that are going to be new for students and are going to be new for teachers. So it's really important to get kids ready to be able to function within those new formats. Charter schools also have board of governance, governance boards, and so one of the things that our principals have done is to start preparing their boards, because there will be impacts. There will be many impacts related to Common Core, and they should be ready for these disruptions, as we called them before. So you should provide sessions on the Common Core and the associated shifts in instruction. It's also important for board members to, when they visit, have clear expectations of what they should see, what they will see in classrooms. So if your board members are thinking that what held true when they were in school, that their teacher was in front of them talking, and all of a sudden they're going to walk in classrooms where there's a lot of student work and a lot of student-centered activities, they should be ready for these. Provide the test samples from Smarter Balanced or PARC. They're already online, and they're very revealing. I myself started with, I believe, 8th grade and dropped down to 3rd grade math fairly quickly. They're quite challenging. Review the possible scenarios and the assessment outcomes and what that means for accountability. You know that New York recently had some changes in the way they looked as a result of the new assessment. So you should review that with your board. And then finally, just a plug for the work that we're doing, which you can find on our website, is to prepare your board for pushback on the Common Core and just make sure that they know how important the Common Core are. Finally, we want to make sure that students, parents in the community are also ready. We have a publication on the Common Core for Parents that you can find on our website. You should be able to provide that in a couple of languages. Offer parent training to support learning at home, with particular emphasis on reading across subject areas. And then finally, offer the parents training on the specific standards through our Padres Comprometidos STEM at home curriculum. Parents actually get training from the content teachers on specific standards, particularly on the middle school standards, and it's helped our parents to have a better understanding of what those are. And with that, I'm going to transfer the presentation to Marisol Revucha.
So first of all, I want to absolutely thank NCLR for the opportunity. And I'm taking a minute to get my screen up here. There we go. For this opportunity. And I'm going to be talking about Common Core implementation at Mac Community Charter School. So as an overview, our school opened in 2001 with the purpose of serving students who were dropping out of school. There, as all of us know, the highest number of dropouts are Latino and African American students. And Mac, a local nonprofit organization here in San Diego, wanted to ensure that there was an alternative, there was a different opportunity for our students who were being pushed out of comprehensive high schools to be able to complete their high school diploma. The beauty of our charter's goal is that we can work with and target students who were disenfranchised, marginalized youth who were pushed out of the system. We're in Chula Vista, California. We're 7 miles from San Diego, 7 miles from Tijuana. So we have some very specific issues and regional issues that we deal with. Our student population, about 50% of our kids are over 18. So we do have students who are older, and we go from ages 14 to 20 years old. We serve students in what we call from 9th to 13th grade. 13th graders are students who didn't graduate and are beyond their original date. So just as you're looking at data, I wanted to explain that. Our students come to us and they face multiple high risk factors. All of us who have been in schools from elementary to middle school, we know that we have those parents that we're chasing after, the parents that we're concerned about what's going on at home. We're concerned that there is drug use, that there could be domestic violence issues. And those students, unfortunately, are students that wind up not making it, or as the term says, they slip through the cracks. And those are the students that we find. And all of the directors and staff before me have very intentionally gone and looked for those students so that we would be able to provide them another opportunity to get their high school diploma. In our location, one of the issues that we do deal with is drug use. And I think that that's also very common with teenagers, especially the use of marijuana. But being here so close to the border, our students do get targeted to cross drugs. And that is one of the things that we do have to deal with. And a lot of our families are involved or have been involved, both moms, dads. Incarceration rates are high in the families and also for some of our students. Students also come because they have not passed the California High School Exit Exam. And that is an exam that's here in California that one of the requirements that students have to they have to pass in order to earn their high school diploma. And our students come because they're credit deficient. Attendance has been an issue, and we work here at making that not an issue. So what is it about our school that works? How are we able to serve these students, and how are we able then to implement Common Core state standards? And what really works about our school is the individualized support that our students receive. The core content standards ask us to prepare students for the world of college and career through high levels of critical thinking, reading, writing, and speaking. So how do we balance those high academic expectations and still meet our particular students' social and emotional needs? And we do that through our program. What we ask of students when they come in is we ask them to be ready to embrace and use their power, which means to reach their potential, take ownership, use wisdom, have high expectations not only of themselves and others, and to be respectful and learn how to earn respect. We also look at youth leadership development, and we provide a lot of individualized support for students. And what is all of that allowed us to do? So looking at this next slide, you can go ahead and read through what our outcomes are, but we have proven through the Western Association of Schools and Colleges, we received accreditation, which means that our classes are the content that we offer is of high, it meets high academic standards. And we do that with this particular group of students. For me, when I look at this slide, the greatest success is our students. Of the six students that you see pictured there, five of them are in college. One is in film school in LA. One is at a local community college getting ready to transfer to Point Loma Nazarene University, which is a local public private school. And the three other students are in a local community colleges, and they're taking over 12 units. And this was the first picture when I opened my graduation folder of pictures. This was the very first picture that I saw. And that, to me, is the greatest celebration of what we're able to do. So how is it that we're able to do that? And what does this have to do with Common Core implementation? What the beauty of charter schools is that we are flexible, that we can be creative. But what I think we all need to do is be very intentional and think about what is the good work that we do at our schools? What makes our schools unique? And how can we intentionally align that good work and connect it to what Common Core is asking us? What Common Core is asking us is what we want for our students and what we've always wanted, that they are at high levels being critical thinkers, readers, writers, listeners, and speakers. So I invite you to think, what are your program components? What is special about your school? What makes your school unique? And in thinking about that, how can you use that and connect it very intentionally with Common Core? Or how are you doing that? And what we do here at Mac Community Charter School is we use critical pedagogy, which is the idea and the practice that we take ownership over ourselves, over our learning through literacy, and through empowering ourselves by taking ownership of our community. And I'll take you through a quick example. In all of our classes, our students and teachers decide if they're going to look at an issue either as an individual student, as a group, or as a class. And they're doing the content learning, so they're learning English, they're learning social science, they're learning math skills, they're learning multimedia video production skills. They're learning skills in their art class, in their PE class. So how are they going to use those skills and look at what is it that's happening in our community? And how can we use those skills to then research what we're identifying as a problem? And in that research, part of the questions that we ask is this something that impacts my community? It's something that's of interest to me. You know, maybe whether or not all schools should be allowed to have off-campus lunch because the food is not good. But is it something that can be done, that we can make an impact on? And then once it's determined that it is, then the students create a plan of action. And they identify what are community resources that can help them. In that, then they create and they try to implement that plan. And the last piece is evaluating the plan. How did it go? Throughout that entire cycle, you're looking at the content standards. The standards are asking us to research, to think, to listen, to write, to read at high levels. And we'll be graduating this year. Their novels were life and what it is that they know. And throughout that, what our students then do in that last piece is they connect to evaluating how did they do in their novel. How did the project or did the questions that they ask, do they have potential for really making an impact on our community? And then when do students get to talk about that? So this is a picture of the cycle of praxis in action. At the end of every quarter, we're a quarter system, our students have a presentation where they showcase the projects and the work that they did. Now, not everybody in a quarter, not all of the projects get completed. So it's not about finishing the project. It's about the process of learning. It's about students looking at and thinking about what it is that they're learning. Again, what Common Core is asking us. This particular picture it shows a collaboration between our environmental science and math class. So students in the environmental science class were looking at the individual health and environmental impact of the maquiladoras in Tijuana and the environmental impact on both sides of the border. The maquiladoras are the industry, the warehousing industry, and that have had a really horrible impact on our local water supply and also on the earth. So students, what you see papers that are hanging down there. In those papers, students are sharing data of what they learned about the impact. Students are writing stories, sharing the interviews of people who have either worked in maquiladoras, looking at the working conditions, or who have had health issues because of the impact. And then also, it's the plan of what students did in order, or what their plan was in order to change this, so that both sides of the border are not having the devastating effects of the current system. And they do then presentations to the community members. So there is that very intentional look at what students are saying and how they're communicating their learning. And this is an example of the rubric that we use. And what's unique about what we do with Showcase is that all of our staff lead a group of students to go and to participate and listen to every single Showcase project, every project that every class did. And then as a class, they look at the different elements. They look at the implementation of the cycle of praxis. They look at how the class or the student connected what they learned connected what they learned content-wise to the project and the connection to power. And then collectively, that group, they listen, they talk, and they justify what their vote would be for the numbers 1, 2, and 3 projects, which content was most content-rich, which project had the greatest community impact or had potential for community impact. And how are we able to do all this work? And we're able to do all this work because of our staff. And it is really important that our professional development in schools and in charter schools specifically, we don't have, traditionally we have not had the funds to bring outside people, so we really have to build from within. So the trainers models, our teachers become experts in Common Core implementation. Our teachers become experts in access resources, such as NCLR and other partner agencies, to bring in information about culturally and linguistically responsive teaching and learning. Our teachers become our models for critical pedagogy. And we also agree as a staff to provide feedback and support to another through our peer feedback process. Where in the classroom, we look at how is critical pedagogy and the cycle of praxis being implemented, and how are we also talking to our students, our staff, and community about how we're using our power and making those connections back to our academics. The Common Core piece has been really critical in the development of our maps. Because we have quarter systems, at the start of every quarter, teachers have an outline of what the content is going to look like and the essential questions that they're going to be asking their students to facilitate the learning in that cycle of praxis. Because it's the class that decides what their projects are going to be and what the questions are, not the teachers. And lastly, we look at how we engage our families here at MCCS. And we've been very fortunate to have been able to partner with NCLR and offer Padres Comprometidos so that we can use that as a springboard, not only to support our parents and family representatives in learning more about the educational system and what they can do to support their students, but also to become voices in other schools. A lot of our parents and families have children in elementary and have children in middle school. So we take that opportunity to teach and talk about Common Core and to help them phrase the questions that they want to ask teachers and principals at other schools about grading and about learning and what that looks like. And also, every opportunity that we have to engage our parents and community, we do. So you see that beautiful picture of our Thanksgiving feast. And those are also opportunities where we can back up and talk about what it is that that we're doing with Common Core. The key for us has been our partnership with outside agencies, including NCLR. And there are great resources available to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Marisa. A great example of an NCLR, wonderful NCLR school. We wanted to have the opportunity to talk to you a little bit more, and perhaps if you have comments or questions, as Aurelia said at the beginning. But we've also put together this checklist for leaders, just some of the things that we thought would be important to show. For our participants. Aurelia, can they, I'm so sorry, is that up, the checklist?
Yes.
Okay, sorry about that. So we put together this checklist for leaders, and we've got several items that we wanted to show you. This checklist, we will be putting it up later on. And we also compiled some resources that we thought you would all find useful in implementing the Common Core. And as well, we have some links to online resources. So we will be making this available to you all. And then, of course, there will be a lot more resources on our Learning from Leaders website that you see how to get there from directly. And so at this point, if you all have questions or comments that you'd like to make, we'd like to open it to the participants.
Thank you, Peggy and Marisol, for sharing your perspective and expertise with us. So participants, if you have questions, remember, please submit those to us via the question box next to the GoToMeeting Notification Center. Our first question is a statement and also a question. That everyone is excited that you're presenting on Service from Learning, Marisol. She also wants to know the fact that you mentioned the importance of partnerships. Do you provide training to local community partners so that they, too, can understand the school needs to meet CCFS?
That is a great idea. We haven't provided the training, but that is a fantastic idea. Aurelia, will you please send me that question?
Sure.
And, yeah, I want to make sure. I think that that's a great next step. It's really important that with our partners that we not only see what it is that they can do to help support our students, but we also look at how we can work together to continue to support the needs of our families. So thank you very much. It's a great question.
And our next question really coincides with that first one. So how could you motivate students to actively participate?
I think you have to set I think that's why I really wanted to hone in on power. You need to set the expectation. Our students, when they come in, they go through a comprehensive enrollment interview. In that interview, we review their history, their academic, their behavioral history, and all of the choices that they made to get them here, and then talk about now's the time to make the change. So in talking about power and having that kind of a school-wide theme, when students aren't engaged, then we have a format, we have a place, we have a set of values that we can go back to and reframe with students to get them engaged. They do have to sign a list of agreements, which includes that they're ready to use their power. So I think it's going back to setting that expectation and holding students to it and doing that as a school. It's not just the administration talking about power, but our teachers and our staff.
Thank you, Marisol. And just a reminder, if you have a question, please submit that via the question chat box located on the GoToMeeting notification panel. Marisol, just one quick, going back to the first question and statement, one of our audience members, Susan, wants to notify you that she has provided that training and she welcomes the opportunity to talk with you offline.
Susan, can you please send me an email? I think my email address is right there on the screen. That is wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, so our next question is, how can we help parents to understand the Common Core State Standards?
This is Peggy. We actually have a parent engagement curriculum, as I mentioned before. It's called Padres Comprometidos. And through Padres Comprometidos, we help parents to understand the Common Core. You can provide, there's the Council of Great City Schools has information, as well as the PTA, the National PTA, has the standards in Spanish, has information about the standards in Spanish. We have a publication also for parents to help them to understand the importance of the standards and, more importantly, how they connect to their own ambitions and their own desires for their children to achieve at high standards because, of course, that means they can go to college, that means they can get an education, a post-secondary education. And really, without sounding too dramatic, really lead the American life. That's what our parents want for their children. If you are interested in more information about Padres Comprometidos, we're happy to provide that to you. We also have, as I mentioned previously, a STEM, it's called STEM at Home, and it's a middle school curriculum to help parents understand STEM education at home, and STEM at home uses, in fact, the standards of math to get parents to understand the standards. So it is possible to connect with parents, connect the standards to what the parents want for their own children, and to see, help them to see how supporting the Common Core state standards is so important.
Thank you, Peggy.
And if this is Marisol, if I could just add a little bit, I think taking advantage of every opportunity you have, parents. So if you are having a school assembly because kids are being recognized, take that opportunity to highlight some part of Common Core. If you have an orientation for new students, take that opportunity. And it doesn't have to be in depth, hour long, but just that constant reminder, that constant information about Common Core helps people become familiar and be able to accept and understand. The other thing that I would suggest is being able to provide questions for them. So these are questions that you should be asking about Common Core. This is, these are the types of questions that you might want to know about your students' learning. Thank you.
Our next question is the STEM at Home curriculum on your website?
No, it is not on the website. You can find information at STEM at Home, and if you can't find any, feel or if you'd like some more, feel free to contact us. The STEM at Home curriculum is one that we make available to our affiliates, and we provide training during the summer on every year on our parent engagement curriculum. But it is available only for our affiliates at this point, although we've made it available to some districts. And a very important part of it is that we feel that we need to train the facilitators who work with parents. NCLR does not do direct training for parents. We go through our affiliates, and they are the ones that have the engagement with parents in their communities, and we feel they are the most effective partners to train parents directly.
Thank you, Peggy. Marisol, this next question is for you. What state resources does MCCS use to help implement the Common Core?
the CDE website has amazing resources for us on both the standards and then also the Smarter Balanced Consortium is what our teachers are using.
Wonderful, thank you. Our next question is, how can non-affiliates access NCLR resources and trainings?
That's a good question. We have we've really focused our resources on our affiliates. It's a very close relationship that we have with them, and that is the benefit, one of the benefits that they receive from affiliating with us. We get, of course, a lot of benefits from having them as affiliates, mainly that what we do with them translates into our national and state work in terms of how informing how we approach our policies or what we advocate for. We can make available, whatever's online, of course, is open to everyone. I would say that if there is more interest in anything in particular, to feel free to contact me, and we can certainly talk about individual cases.
Thank you, Peggy. Our next question is whether or not today's PowerPoint will be available online or only to registered participants. So to clarify that, today's presentation along with previously recorded presentations will be available on the Learning from Leaders website. That website is listed on your screen right now. It's www.nclr.org/LFL. On there, you'll find access to this presentation along with a vast amount of other resources in the areas of leadership development, English learners, parent engagement, and mission, vision, and planning. Along with that, the checklist that Peggy discussed with you all earlier, that is available on there. Other Common Core State Standards are available on there as well. Today's presentation slides will be available very soon, within the next day or two. And a recording of this webinar will also be available on the website. To access it, you'll go to the webinar tab from the home page, and you can have access to that along with any other webinars we have hosted. The presentation slides and the webinar is there. You can download and share through YouTube if you have access to the internet. Are there any other questions? Peggy and Marisol, that is the conclusion of our questions. Do you guys have any closing remarks?
Marisol, go ahead.
I just, first of all, again, thank you for the opportunity. And I think it's just really important that we remember that flexibility, creativity, and intentionality is what we is going to help us get through. This isn't something new. We shouldn't see it as something extra. We shouldn't see it as something else that's being done to us. But it's really the Common Core State Standards are a tool that we can use to get our students where it is that we know we want them to be, so that they can be successful adults in the very near future. So be flexible, be creative, and be intentional, and have a great day.
Thank you, Marisol. Thank you so much for partnering with NCLR, as you always do. I just wanted to leave you all with a final thought, which is that NCLR is engaged in work, Common Core State Standard work, to make sure that there is not a rollback of these incredible standards in certain states, and so we'll be posting more information on that on our website, so please look out for that, and thank you so much for participating in this webinar today.
That concludes our session. Thank you all for joining this webinar on behalf of the National Council of La Raza and Verizon.